Hi, I'm Andrew from Creative Guitar Studio. And over the weekend, I had a question sent to me off my YouTube channel from Ashley Smith out in England. He wrote in saying, I'd like to know how to improvise more melodically over a chord progression in any key. Being aware of the scales and mode positions for shapes along the length of the neck that I can use to solo over a specific chord. And also how to pick out the chord tones and the strong notes, you know, like resolving a lick or riff to the root and including other chord tones, etc. Also, some advice on practicing the scales and modes around chord progressions would also be ideal. Well, thanks for writing in, Ashley. You know, there's no doubt that practicing scales and modes is certainly vital for developing a strong ability to solo melodically. However, there are many players like you that are finding difficulty with developing this skill. The key to tapping your full potential in this department will have to do with the mastery of several concepts. I'm going to go through three of them quickly, and we're going to cover each one in detail. Number one, practicing scales with a goal in mind of stretching your skills with them. In other words, never get stuck in a rut of constantly practicing scales day in, day out in the exact same way. And we're going to cover this more. Number two, learning other players' lines, guitar licks, and phrasing styles. It's vital. So what I'm saying is find a handful of guitar players that you really dig and learn at least an album's worth of their rhythm and lead lines. And yes, you heard me correctly. I said rhythm and lead. And we're going to talk about that a little bit more as well. Now, number three, practice composing melodies when you practice improvisation. It's simply not enough to just sit around, you know, working on jamming out on a random jam track or something in an entirely unstructured way every practice session. When you play along to jam tracks, you know, of course, spin the jam track and practice the jam, but practice composing something every single day that you play the guitar. So let's cover each of these areas in a little more detail, starting with stretching yourself when practicing scales. When you first begin practicing scales, you'll likely be memorizing the patterns off of some kind of diagram drawing. And after the scale becomes memorized, you'll want to immediately start working with a metronome to get your timing together. I usually suggest to students to shoot for around 100 beats per minute, performing 16th notes. Now, after those initial trials of getting the speed up with the 16th notes has started to come together for you, you want to, as soon as possible, move into the world of triplets. And the first triplet feel that you'll get involved with is going to be the slower one of eighth note triplets. But as soon as you can, progress over to the world of 16th note triplets as well. Now, you may have to slow the metronome right down to perform the 16th note triplets. Things get pretty hectic when you're at anything over about 72 to 80 when you're dealing with 16th note triplets. Now, what I'm going to do is just zoom in on the neck and give you a quick demonstration of this. After the initial memorization period, make regular scale practice into a routine and practice scales for a long time. And I mean, like literally months until the shapes are completely burnt into your subconscious mind. Now, during this period though, you'll also want to work on some other things, you know, some isolation games with the shapes and some sequencing and some different layouts of the shapes. Now, what I mean by that is, let's say, you know, you take into consideration some type of an isolation exercise where basically you'll, you know, a common one that I've worked on is working in between specific string sets. So for example, let's say you're going to play between like fifth string to second string only. And another good one is to work horizontally just within a region, like let's say from between fifth fret to maybe 10th or 11th fret. And try to move, you know, ascending and descending through the various, you know, different locations of the scale. Of the geometrical shape, that is. Now, another good thing you can work on is something called three-note per string scale shapes. You can also try four-note per string scale shapes. Another really good idea is sequencing, and I'm going to cover this for sure in the demo that I'll do in a moment. But common ones that I'd really recommend looking at are the fourths that are the ascending and descending fourths, and also working in diatonic thirds. So let's zoom in on the neck and just go over some of these ideas in detail. The first thing I'd like to discuss is just the idea of going up one scale pattern and then down another. I'm going to start with my baby finger on a C note on the 6th string 8th fret. And then I'm going to climb up a C major scale from there. Kind of more or less sticking in the 5th position. And then what I'm going to do is when I get to the top of that scale, I'm going to slide forwards and go around seventh position now and descend. So I went up one. With all the patterns along the entire length of your fingerboard. Another really cool idea that you can work with is isolating regions. And what I'll do is I'll play only on the top three strings for an isolation game. And I'm just gonna kind of do it maybe between about 6th or 7th fret to about 13th fret. I'm gonna stay in only one location and just try and play randomly, you know, just melodically as I can and come up with some interesting movements. And it's pretty improvised, so we'll see what happens here. Trying to make sure you know where your roots are. I knew in that region that I had a root on the first string on the 8th fret, and I had another root of C on the 13th fret of 2nd string. So those games are really good to play, just isolating. Now another really good concept to work on is something called 3-note per string scales, and they're actually excellent for 16th note triplet ideas. They really help with that. So I'm going to do one starting on the 8th fret of the 6th string, and I'm just going to carry on every string there, just making sure I have 3 notes on each string for the scale pattern. That's all there is to it. It's fairly simple. All you do is you look at your shapes, you combine them in a way, and you can easily do it, you know, where you can just have 3 notes per string. You can also do 4-note per string ideas, but when you start working with 4-note per string scale shapes, you'll either go very lateral quite quickly, or what you'll find is you'll have unisons showing up with the 4-note per string style. I'm going to move on now to sequence patterns. I want to discuss one that's sort of a favorite of mine. It's diatonic thirds. So we're inside the key of C major. We're staying there. We're not using any notes outside of the key. That's what diatonic refers to. And what we're going to do is play third sequences. So we're going to start off going from C to E, which is a major third. Then we're going to go from a D to an F, which is a minor third. Then from an E to a G, which is another minor third. Then F to the A, which is a major third. And then a G to a B, which is another major third. And then we're going to go from the A back to the C, which is another minor third. So the sequence just goes like this. These are excellent exercises. There's lots of different kinds of sequencing that you can be doing. Just look it up on the net, and I'm sure you'll see bucket loads of different kinds of sequences that you could practice. But they are great for technique. Well, next I'd like to talk for a moment about the importance of learning from other players. You know, why reinvent the wheel when there's just so much that you can quickly absorb from all the fantastic guitar players in the world? And any decent guitarist worth his or her name has an album out. And if you dig the player, then get their album and learn their material. Plus, there are enough books and magazines, DVDs, YouTube videos, and tab websites out there to sink a battleship. So take advantage of all that this has to offer and start learning licks from the masters. You know, on my lessons website, for instance, in the members area, I have a series that I'm running called Quick Licks. And these video lessons and accompanying tab worksheets cover licks in all musical styles and will supply you with a booster shot of guitar licks when you need a quick flip of inspiration, you know, when you're playing. But you also need to understand that the guitar scales world doesn't really begin and end with just licks. It's equally important to learn melody lines. And one of the best ways that I've always found for learning that is through vocal melodies from songs that you find interesting. And one of the groups I did this with was Steely Dan. I learned all the vocal melody lines from the albums of Royal Scam and Asia. And that led me to studying music of a lot of the instrumental jazz and fusion players. Like I got into Tom Scott for a while, I got into Freddie Hubbard, I liked, you know, Miles Davis stuff. And that kind of led me over into instrumental guitar players as well. I got into the shredder players like Steve Vai and Joe Satriani, Steve Morris, Tony McAlpine. They all became a huge inspiration for me, you know, at a certain period in my life. And they became really important in what they were doing technically in my own practice routine. And the ways that I found that all of these people influenced me the most was just how their scale passages and melody lines, runs and licks and so forth on the fingerboard It just how they performed them, they each had a style and a way that they laid out things on the neck, and it really opened my eyes to all the various geometry of how scales operate on the guitar and how I could begin incorporating that to create lines and ideas and passages in my own playing. Next, I'd like to go into discussion about the importance of actually composing melodies. And what this really does for you is it gets you away from just regurgitating the same kinds of licks and lines and runs with the scale layouts that you probably always do, you know, when you grab the guitar to work on improvisation. But the other thing too is I want to get into the aspect of when you're doing composing, there's also songwriting that plays a role in that, because you're going to want to create backing tracks to compose to. And the other side of it is the music theory elements that are involved in actually thinking about playing into and around certain chords and how chords fit together and so on and so forth. So let's just take a step back for a second and think about, you know, when most guitar players first get into working with scales and jam tracks to develop their improvisational ability, they seldom make a decision to compose an actual melody line over top of a jam track. You know, on one hand, of course, this is getting into the skills that are necessary to learn what it takes to create your own jam tracks. And that involves a lot of things, you know, like learning how to build drum loops, building beats, learning about working inside audio editing software, learning about digital recording, and so on. It's all, of course, vital. But besides that, there's the flip side of understanding how to create those jam tracks. And it's also obviously going to require good knowledge of harmony and theory, and in particular, chord construction and intervals. So, you know, in both composing the jam track and then later performing over top of it, you'll simply be miles ahead if you know and completely understand your music theory. I have a good deal of video lessons online which cover everything from key signatures to interval design, but two really solid tips that I can suggest for you in, you know, helping you get to be able to do important concepts like chord tone targeting and so forth, and really knowing your overall scale layout and fingerboard layout, would be, number one, to write out your fingerboard. Just grab a piece of diagrammatic drawing paper of the fingerboard and write the neck out. Take pencil to paper and do it several times, or do it digitally in a computer program, or there's some software out there that I know that does layout of the neck and so forth. You know, as an instructor for going on 20 years now, I cannot tell you how many times that I've drawn out the guitar fingerboard, and trust me, it really, really helps a lot. Now, the second thing that I know helped me immensely when I learned how to do it was to actually learn how to proficiently read and write music. Not tab, you know, but the traditional music notation. And this is probably the best way that a guitarist can completely 100% learn the notes on the guitar neck, literally at a glance. And learning to both read and write notation will improve your note knowledge and your rhythm concepts like you could never imagine. And the results after you develop this skill will literally blow your mind. And if you get into the habit of notating your compositions, your skills at composing will grow by leaps and bounds. So as you can tell, developing a high awareness of working with scales and modes is a ton of work. And we didn't even get into discussions about arpeggios. But, you know, I can clearly recall when I was at GIT asking on occasion many teachers and famous players who came to the school for clinics and seminars about how they practiced scales and how they worked on the fingerboard. And the answers were always pretty much the same. They just would say they worked on them for years and years and years, literally thousands of hours developing their scales and their fingerboard knowledge. And every one of them doing very different kinds of studies and exercises. You know, a lot of the things that I discussed with you today are things that I gleaned off a lot of people that I've met over the years, whether it was Paul Gilbert or Scott Henderson or Al Di Meola or even Robin Ford or whoever. There are a lot of famous people that I got a chance to meet when I was out in LA. They always said the same thing. They just practiced for hours upon hours upon hours upon hours. So anyway, I hope this helps you. Thanks for watching. Keep jamming on this stuff. Be sure to follow me on Twitter for lesson material updates. All the links are in the description box below. Take care, everybody, and I'll catch up with you next time. Bye for now.